Charles Corey for Mr. Velasco. May it please the court. I think you can summarize the unreasonableness of this case in one sentence. And that's when the trial judge, at the end of the interview of juror 112, said to her, "I wish I had known about this yesterday." And then proceeded to do nothing. He had three alternates who had just been sworn in that jury the day before. The trial had not started. No witnesses had testified. Just opening statements.
Were you the trial lawyer?
I wasn't, no, Your Honor. I wasn't the trial lawyer. I'm appointed by the court. He pro se'd in the district court, and your court issued a certificate of appealability, and I was appointed. So I wasn't the trial lawyer, and I haven't talked to the trial lawyer. But I'm focusing on that. And it is, I mean, a trial lawyer, and I've tried cases. That's the first thing you think about. And I've tried this fact situation out. Try to save 2 minutes. I've tried this fact situation out on other attorneys, and they always say, well, what happened to the alternates? Were they hit by a truck? Were there no alternates? What's going on? I mean, it's so obvious.
Well, I think on de novo review, you'd have a better argument on this record, but we're here on habeas review, so there has to be an unreasonable application of clearly established federal law as articulated by the Supreme Court. What's your best theory as to the unreasonable application of clearly established federal law?
What's my best Supreme Court of the United States case? It's an old case. It's a good case. Toomey versus Ohio. We're talking about structural error here. In other words, that was a biased judge. He was the mayor of a small city. And he only got paid when he found people guilty. A little bit of a problem, a biased judge. Jurors are judges. Okay, that's Toomey versus Ohio. That is my case. That is clearly established federal law that it is structural error to have a biased judge, juror.
He made a factual determination that she could be fair.
And it was an unreasonable factual determination because of the process.
Well, you have to read the whole colloquy.
Oh, the whole colloquy, I read it and I put it in my brief.
Right.
Okay, remember the prosecutor comes out and first thing he says, well, right now, if you had to go to the jury room, how would you find...
I think you have to...
It stages.
You know,
everything was guilty.
Well, no, wait a minute, though. You need to... When I first read the colloquy, I found it troubling, like you did. And I couldn't quite figure out what was going on here. And then it caught my eye that this all occurred after opening statements, correct?
Both sides. They had opening statements.
They had opening statements. And defense counsel, when he gives his opening statement, he says, tells the jury, you know, it was wrong what he did. It was illegal what he did. He just didn't engage in force. It was voluntary sex with these young girls. He committed a crime, but not the crimes that are charged, something less.
And then they spoke to that.
And that's what that was his, you know, he says, you're going to hear, I'm going to bring an expert on and all this stuff. I mean, he laid out what his case was going to be.
Right.
And that's at the end of the day after they select the jury, right?
That's right.
Then the next day, the next morning, juror 112 comes in and says, hey, I got to share some information with the court.
Excuse me.
We had something.
I have a problem.
No,
I have a problem with this teacher. I know teachers.
Yeah.
I have children.
Right.
Her child was in the same class as her colleague who taught and molested other kids. She is never, ever, ever going to forget that, Your Honor. I'm sorry. Never, never, never. I'm a parent. Any parent, the minute they found out that their child, and she was more than a parent, she was a teacher. That's huge.
When she's questioned, though, she makes reference to the opening statements.
She didn't say what, in voir dire, on my other case, Justice Wynn, Judge Wynn, asked me what's my best case? Well, there's another great case about voir dire. That's the McDonough case I cited, and I cited them all. I cited the Supreme Court case. That's a civil case. Doesn't make any difference. The Supreme Court said we have to have good voir dire, or jurors get seated who don't get shouldn't be seated. And then there's a criminal case on page 14 of my brief, the Rosales case, where it says how important voir dire is to get an unbiased jury.
But that's the heart of the question in this case. Was there a biased juror seated in this case? And, you know, sitting here at the Court of Appeals, it's very difficult to review a cold record. It's really the trial judge that's looking at the juror. You know, she waffled back and forth. There's no question about it. And some of her answers in isolation would seem very, very troubling. That would indicate perhaps some sort of bias. And it was up to the trial judge to explore that and to figure it out. So when the trial judge says, I'm not going to excuse her. I think it's not an easy situation, but I really don't think it's that close of a call either. This juror struck me as very sincere, and it seems to me, on the whole, indicate that she could follow the court's instructions. What are we going to do with that? Because we didn't have a chance to assess that juror by looking at her in the eyes.
What you're going to do with it is ask the same question that all my practitioners have asked me. The process was faulty and unreasonable. We have process. We have alternate jurors just for this. Why? How could it possibly be reasonable for that judge not, when these facts are so, they're so pointing towards bias, giving the doubt to the defendant and saying, thank you, I know you're sincere. And he did say, I sure wish I could have found out yesterday. What did that mean? It means that she wouldn't have been on the jury if she had found out.
What did the defense lawyer do that was there?
He said, I don't want her on my jury. I want you to issue a challenge for cause. And the judge said, denied.
You don't have to get so excited.
I'm sorry.
You look a little like Mark Twain, you know.
Thank you. That's a compliment.
You have to have the sense of humor.
Thank you for that. Thank you for that.
Well, his argument was that she didn't reveal in the voir dire.
Well, prior of course, I mean, and for the voir dire and an attorney to have something like that, your heart's got to sink. I know voir dire. I've done it. And he must have felt 2 feet tall. How did this person escape? Well, she escaped by being quiet. I'm sorry. And she knew. Once again, reasonability is not... I think what the court is focusing on,
They point out that we've got these alternates.
Three alternates.
Yeah, I know, but did he remind the judge of that?
Did he remind the judge of that, the defense attorney?
Yeah.
He didn't have to. They just...
No, don't say he didn't have to.
I would have been yelling now, okay? Yeah. You're right. I'm sorry he didn't have a tantrum. I would have had a tantrum. I've been to jail before, okay? Once a judge has sent you to jail, you can have tantrums.
You've been to jail?
Yes, I have.
What jail?
1974, San Diego. Judge Jack Levitt sent me to jail, arguing to a jury in a cop killing case. 1974.
How much time did they give you?
The Court of Appeal got me out pretty fast. A couple of hours. I was strip searched, and he wanted to break my spirit. It didn't work. He's not there. I'm still here.
I can see that.
You know. Thank you. Yeah, He's gone. I'm still here.
So he has a lawyer there.
I wish he would have said
the
that.
The lawyer didn't even point out that there were alternates.
I know. And he didn't. But that's not a forfeiture. That's not a forfeiture. No. I think he was in shock. I really do. I think he was in shock that juror stayed on the jury. He was in shock because they said, oh, my God. A lawyer's worst nightmare. I've got a biased juror, and I can't do anything about it.
Well,
and that's unreasonable. Don't, you know, this.
You want me to keep turning my hearing aids off and on with the volume here?
I'm also not leaving any time, am I?
You know, you make a good argument. So just quit yelling before.
Maybe I should just sit down.
I'll
sit down.
Before we get you another strip.
Okay, right. I did bring my toothbrush. I really do have
it. Did you?
Thank you.
What toothpaste you use?
I didn't bring that because I was afraid it would make a mess.
Well, we
electric toothbrush.
The marshal will give you toothpaste.
Okay,
don't worry.
You.
We'll take care of that.
All right. We'll hear from the state.
May it please the court, California Deputy Attorney General Kimberly Donahue on behalf of Respondent Appellee. The district court's denial of the habeas petition in this case was proper, and this court should affirm. There was no unreasonable application of clearly established federal law by the state courts, and the trial court did not make any unreasonable determination of fact in this case about whether or not juror number 112 was biased. Petitioner has failed to meet his burden of establishing that bias of juror number 112, either
well,
through...
Well, look, I'll tell you what I feel about this case. All the judge had to do was to excuse this woman, put on an alternate juror, and that would have ended it. We wouldn't be here today. And why in the world he didn't do that is just beyond my comprehension. And why the defense attorney didn't suggest it, that's another mystery to me. But it's such a simple thing to do. And this juror had a daughter she was concerned about, and with what happened in the school and all the rest of it, hard for me to believe that somehow that slipped her mind. And so I just think this judge blew it down there. It's been a simple thing. You bring the alternate on, everybody proceeds, trial goes on. That's the end of it.
You're right, although I don't think that what the juror articulated in this particular case amounted to what would be grounds for a challenge for cause. It may have been grounds for the defense attorney had it been disclosed during the primary.
Well, it was grounds for challenge for cause.
Well, I think what the trial court essentially was discussing when he discussed that, you know, he wished he had learned of this information during voir dire is that it may have been a challenge that or could have been grounds for a peremptory challenge that the defense attorney could have used. And I think we know that because there was a second juror that was actually interviewed or they actually spoke with after speaking with juror 112. And in that exchange, at the end of that exchange, the court said, again, I wish that I had known this because I think it could be grounds for a peremptory challenge. But the court, it seems, was clearly stating that it did not believe that what she had disclosed was grounds for cause. And when you look at what she was talking about, Your Honor mentioned that her daughter had been taught.
You can tell me all the words you want. You're not going to change my mind on this. I mean, to me, it's just so simple and so clear.
Well, and I think that there are certain things, though, that this juror did say that indicated that she could be fair and impartial in this case. And that's the standard that the court needed to determine.
Oh, you can get almost any juror to say that.
And
I
think...
You can ask them, will you follow all the court's instructions? They'll always say yes. Can you put that aside? Yes. But here, if you look at this situation, it's to me, it's obvious that you don't want a person like that on a jury.
Well, I think
because their impartiality is very easy to challenge. So why not just put another alternate on, just go that way?
And again, it's because the court in this case determined that it was not the basis for a challenge for cause. And I understand Your Honor's disagreement with that. Ultimately,
well, that's all right. You can talk to somebody else. Go
ahead. Well, I think, you know, when you take everything in its entirety, and I understand your concern, and I think there were, as the court has pointed out, some troubling statements made.
Why don't you talk a little slower?
My apologies.
No, it's not you, it's me. Your generation likes to talk really, really fast. And good thing that, how would Abraham Lincoln have and looked upon at Gettysburg, if he said, you know, four squares ever just go to Father Pickett. Thank you.
Yes, Your Honor. Yeah. Well, ultimately, in this case, though, the juror did come, once it was explained to her that she could only rely on the evidence as it was presented at the trial and that she would have to follow the law as instructed by the court, she indicated that she would be able to do that. And the court's crediting her as being a believable, as being believable in what she was talking about, believable in the sense that she did not believe or she did not recall this incident during voir dire. And as the district court pointed out, during voir dire, the questions were specifically with respect to family members or close friends or the jurors themselves being involved in crimes that were similar to those that were charged here. And none of those categories meet what this juror was describing in this event. It was an event that happened by a former colleague of hers after her daughter was no longer a student of that colleague. And when she describes whether or not it was a significant event in her life, the defense counsel actually asked her that. She says, no, not in my life. And she specifically started referencing her former colleagues saying they felt betrayed and they thought it may have been significant. But she no longer worked with this individual. Her daughter was no longer a student of this individual. And in that sense, the trial court credited her as not having remembered it the day before. And as the district court also pointed out, the juror coming forward with this the very next morning after voir dire, after opening statements, before any evidence, is inconsistent with any sort of intent to conceal.
Look, here's some of the things she said. Well, it's pretty much the same situation. My thought this morning was, why didn't he turn himself in, just like the teacher did? That's the teacher that was a bad person. It just popped into my head. He could have turned himself in, avoided a trial. So I don't know that I can separate that now. I've remembered the situation. And then she also stated, knowing your opening statements, I would have to vote guilty. And then another statement, even if force in the context was not proven beyond a reasonable doubt, I don't think I would be able to vote not guilty.
Yes, she did make those statements, Your Honor. The court did, however, then clarify to her that whether or not somebody turns himself in...
If that's in your mind, it's, you know...
The court specifically asked her, though.
You could just put some words in front of someone and they say, yes, that's all going to go away.
Yes, and I think that again, courts have held that this level of perfection is not something that our judicial system requires for jurors. Jurors do come into a courtroom with their past experiences. And in this case, this juror did say that she could follow the court's instructions, including the instruction that whether or not he turned himself in is not evidence. So ultimately, the fact that she, when it was explained to her what she could and could not consider in rendering a verdict, which is the evidence presented at trial, and the judge's instructions as to the law, she said that she could absolutely follow those instructions and that she would rely only on the evidence. And while, again, those statements in isolation are troublesome, I think all the courts have recognized that. We recognize that. Taking the entire colloquy together, it suggests that she was not biased. It establishes that she's not biased, and petitioner did not meet his burden of establishing that she was biased, either by concealing or actually so.
What was the sentence here? Remember?
I apologize, Your Honor.
I looked it up yesterday.
I apologize, Your Honor. I don't know that off the top of my head. He was sentenced to 123 years to life in state prison.
Under what?
123 years to life.
To life. 123 years to life.
Yes, sir.
So this all occurred after the opening statement, correct?
It did, Your Honor, yes. And so as was pointed out previously, the juror was basing a lot of her answers to would you vote guilty or not guilty based on that opening statement, the themes that were presented by counsel there. But then ultimately when it was explained to her...
When I just read the colloquy, I found it very troubling, as Judge Pregerson has elaborated. But then when I read the opening statement, it would be surprising if any juror who had been confronted, having heard those opening statements, and then been confronted with these kinds of questions, how would you vote, when defense counsel gets up there and says...
It's wrong what he did.
Wrong what he did. It was illegal what he did. He's guilty of something, but he's not guilty of, essentially, of rape, is what he was saying.
Correct. And I've seen that my time's run out, but if I may address. Absolutely. And again, when you're asked as a lay juror, how would you vote, having just heard opening statements, a lay juror is not expected to understand at that moment, given that hypothetical, that opening statements are not evidence and that she cannot rely on solely...
And the judge allowed that question to be asked.
The judge did allow that question.
Yeah, it's kind
but,
of stupid, isn't it?
Well, I think what the judge did afterwards is actually then explain. I believe the prosecutor was the one who asked that question.
Yeah, well,
the judge then...
That's why we're here today.
And the judge then clarified that the only thing that the juror could consider when rendering a verdict was the evidence that was actually presented at trial. Once the juror understood that, and again, that's a distinction that we don't hold our jurors to understand, absent being instructed that by the court. So once that clarification was made by the court, the juror more clearly said, oh, I can follow the instructions given by the court.
Yeah, well, that's a great jury, and the guy gets, how many years?
123.
23.
To life, yes.
123. All right,
okay.
Well.
Thank you. Unless there's any further questions.
I don't know. No,
I hope they got a good library up there.
Thank you.
Okay. You can have a minute.
Nah.
1 minute. Yeah,
and keep your voice down.
I will keep
my
voice down.
I'm going to send you to a Marine barber and get your hair cut.
That happened to me.
I know.
Can I get extra time because I have to answer?
No, that did happen to me.
I was in the Navy.
You were in the Navy.
I was in the Navy, and I was on a submarine in 1962. Please,
what submarine?
It was the USS Razorback, and it was the Cuban Missile Crisis.
Oh, the
Cuban Missile Crisis, 1962. I was in South China Sea. But I went, I've got to tell you this story, because the distillers broke, and we only had enough water for the batteries. So no one could shave. No one got haircuts. And then another submarine said, we want Mr. Corey. He's supposed to be on our submarine. The Midway sent a helicopter to pick me up, and they took me in this state with a huge afro and my Navy hat sitting on top of it, a big beard, to the Midway, dropped me on the flight deck to transfer me to Iwakuni Marine Air Base.
I know where
Iwakuni is. You know where Iwakuni is.
It's in Japan.
It's in Japan, and that's where my submarine was.
I was there when they took you out of the brig. You
know? The Marines were shocked, and they said, who is this with this afro and smells so bad? Because diesel submarine sailors smell awful, especially when there's no water and you're submerged for days and days. And it was the colonel tracked me down. Because for some reason, there was something in me that you see now that liked looking that way. And they tracked me down, and they actually took me by force
to
the barber
chair. You're a worse storyteller than I am.
I had to tell you because you opened the door.
I know.
Okay. All right, so we got 1 minute.
1 minute. Now the minute starts. Thank you.
Send me 5 copies of it. Go ahead.
I'm going to answer just Judge Paez's thing about the opening statement. This is really important. Bingo. This is a bingo point. On page 11 of my brief, the judge asked, well, what if defense counsel's right? There was no force. She said, I don't care. He's still guilty. See what I mean? That's in the colloquy. What if defense counsel's right? And it was proven there was no force. She said, even if it was no force, I wouldn't be able to vote not guilty. And it was because she had a health teacher tell her that in his position of trust, and she, in his position of trust as a teacher, and he was a teacher, this person is a teacher, and a karate teacher, you can't, but that was not a defense. He'd still be guilty. She couldn't get rid of that. Even if the opening statement is she believed it was proven the defense counsel was right. So that answers your point.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you so much.
All right. Matter is submitted. Thank you very much, counsel.